Hey everyone, welcome back to Today in Tech. I'm Juliet Beauchamp and I'm here with Macworld Executive Editor Michael Simon as well as Computerworld Executive Editor Ken Mingis. We are live on YouTube as well as on LinkedIn, so if you have any questions or comments while we are talking and discussing, please do let me know. We also have a special double feature episode today, so we'll be talking today with Ken and Mike a little bit about just some chip things at large. Intel's new CPUs, the Google Pixel 6 powered by its own chip. And then later in the show, we're going to have Mario Morales, the Program Vice President for Enabling Technologies and Semiconductors at IDC, on to talk about the ongoing chip shortage. So if you had any questions about either of those things, please do let us know. So before we start, it's applicable to the conversation. Ken, you have a new baby?
I have, yeah.
The new M1 Max.
Yeah. I it was a long journey. I had tried to order one on the day that they were announced last week, and my delivery date was going to wind up being like mid to late November. So I lucked up and managed to order one for pickup on Tuesday when they actually were released. So ordered it about 8 a.m. on Tuesday and had it in hand about 11:30. Just now getting the to know it is a phenomenal machine. I'm sure I will never put it through the paces in a way that somebody who's doing video editing or, you know, crunching databases and running virtual machines, things like that. But it should certainly keep me going for the next 3, 4, 5 years. Although I know Michael probably doubts that will be the case, but that's the
plan. Well, I heard you went to the Apple store and demanded, yelling in the middle of the store, do you know who I am?
No.
Demanding that they give you your computer.
No.
That's what I heard.
I very quietly got online. I paid too much attention to the Mac Rumors forums about the best way to do this and skip the line. And so I jumped online first thing this Tuesday morning and it worked.
Fair and square.
And I will say this, I'm glad I did, because I was just checking before we started talking, and this may go back to the point you were making earlier, Juliet, about chip shortages and things. These are no longer available for pickup, at least locally where I am in Raleigh, North Carolina. And if you order one now, you'll get it probably around the 1st of December, something like that, or the first week of December. So that's, for pretty much a major product for Apple, that's a pretty good backup.
Yeah.
Delay, I mean, in terms
so,
of.
So how's that M1 Max treating you?
So far, so good. There have been some issues. I think people have complained that Safari doesn't really do the promotion in the way that it should. And I think everybody's assuming that's going to require a quick software update. The notch is not an issue for me, as it were. But I'm
what do you mean about the promotion? I haven't.
Okay. Yeah. That. There's apparently, if you do scrolling in Safari, and I think maybe Chrome as well, right. It doesn't appear that the promotion is bumping up to 120.
Really?
Again, my eyes are not as focused on this as apparently a lot of people. There's a lot of discussion about it. Again, if you take a look at the Mac Rumors forums. In terms of like when you move Windows around the desktop, when you're pinching and zooming and stuff, smooth as butter. I mean, you can tell clearly it's 120, but yeah. It with some scrolling in Safari, it stutters a little bit. Some people say,
okay.
Yeah, interesting. But again, in terms of the notch, it took me, all of a day to realize I don't care. It's not bothering me. It doesn't get in the way of any of my menu items at the menu bar. And so I'm a happy camper.
We got conflicting comments last week on our episode. One person was very much on your team, Ken. No one cares about the notch. But another person, to your point, Mike, very insistent that they do not like the notch.
We're going to get that from here until the end of whenever.
Mm-hmm.
It's a polarizing feature. It's been for the iPhone now forever, and it was same thing with on Android phones. I mean, it is it's a thing, and if your eyes can't not see it, it's gonna be a nuisance. That's just the way it's gonna go.
So
there it is, the notch.
There it is.
No, it's not.
Yeah, and it's big, and it's noticeable. And if you Apple can say all they want, well, you're getting the same amount of screen space, and all that is true, but you can convince your brain, but not your eyes, if you will. So
fair enough.
You have to think about it as the screen real estate below the notch is full screen.
Again, sure. Semantics.
So the menu bar above it is the extra.
It's just a change in mindset.
Let me drink some more
iPhone 10 was the same
Kool-Aid,
thing.
Mike.
Let me just same, it's the same situation of the as the iPhone. It's still there.
All right. Yeah. I think let's talk a little bit about the chips at hand. So talked a little bit about this M1 Max, Ken, and you're enjoying it. But I wanted to talk a little bit about, so Intel just yesterday sort of formally introduced its 12th generation Alder Lake CPUs. And one of them in leaked benchmarks seems to outperform the new M1 Max by a hair. And I think last week we had even said something along the lines of, you know, new Intel chips are going to come out. How fast are they going to be? It seems like the answer is pretty powerful.
Yeah, well, let's explain a few things before we get into this. So Alder Lake, what Intel released,
right,
are desktop CPUs. They're brand new. They are built on a 7-nanometer process for the first time. Intel's been doing 10 and promising 7 forever. But they finally got to 7. And it's a completely different architecture. So they're doing what Apple is doing, what AMD is doing with these cores. So they have high efficiency cores and high performance cores inside these desktop processors. So it's a completely different chip. And in some ways, it's a direct response to these types of chips. Apple's before the M1, the A-series chips and AMD's chips, which have kind of been eating Intel's lunch for a while now. Intel is still a big name. They still sell a ton of processors, and they're still, you know, among the fastest around. But when you're talking about a modern chip architecture, they didn't have what these chips have with these types of cores. So this is a change for them. Alder Lake is basically an M1, essentially, an Intel version of an M1 chip. So the ones that they released, they absolutely destroy the M1 because they're desktop chips and they're optimized for performance. We haven't seen the M1 Pro, M1 Max in an iMac, or certainly not a Mac Pro, which is what these chips are destined for, those higher end machines. So what Intel released this week isn't a fair comparison. Now, what you're talking about is leaked benchmarks of the mobile version of that chip.
Yes.
The Alder Lake chip, which, I mean, yes, the benchmarks that we've seen leaked do by a hair beat the M1 Max by the smallest of margins. And we don't know. So they were run obviously using Windows 11. Windows 11 does some optimization stuff with hyper-threading or whatever it's called. So we don't really know the actual comparison, apples to apples, no pun intended, performance. I'm not surprised at all that these chips will, you know, meet what Apple has done with the M1 Max. I mean, Intel's a chip company. If they don't, what are they doing?
Totally.
So I'm not, that doesn't surprise me at all. What is a little, you know, as a Macworld editor, it's a little irritating that as soon as this happens, everyone's like, oh, look, Apple's terrible. Like, listen, Apple basically makes chips on the side, and they're making them as good as what was once the biggest and the best and the most, the number one chip maker in the world. And Intel is playing a little bit of catch up here. There's no real denying it. Apple, the M1 Max is, it's a ridiculously good chip. And I'm sure the M2 Max next year or maybe 2023, whenever we get it, is going to take that even further. And you can't deny that Apple right now is a major player, both in the chip making business and in how the entire landscape is shifting towards these types of chips.
You know, we talked about this a couple of weeks back, and this is exactly what we were talking about, is that what Apple is doing with its whole chip design manufacturing process is spurring innovation in a way that, you know, Intel has not had this kind of competition. I know it's got competition with other, you know, AMD and others, but, you know, this is the sort of thing that is good on both sides of the ocean, if you will, because both companies, you know, will look to compete on both, not just speeds, but like, you know, heat, battery life for mobile devices.
Well, that's the other thing we don't know.
Right.
Is that, you know, benchmarks are in a vacuum.
One benchmark leaked does not mean that a Windows 11 machine running the Alder Lake chip is going to run either as fast, as cool, or as long as the MacBook Pro.
And you know, the fact that Intel's that Apple's in the conversation is a win for Apple. I mean, this is their first high performance chip for a Mac. That's it. The M1 was not that. It was very much low end. Even though it was in the 13-inch MacBook Pro, it wasn't a high end chip. This is. And the fact that Intel's, you know, so Alder Lake, we're probably looking at a 2 to 4 year roadmap or whatever it is. Apple's already there, you know, and Apple's roadmap is going to be what it is. We don't know yet because we've only had the first generation of these. So for all we know, the M2 Max doubles performance and Intel's back to the drawing board. So, well, you know,
you said Alder Lake is a 7-nanometer chip. Isn't the M1 Pro a
5?
Five.
And the M2 is probably going to be a 5 as well, but the M3 will be, the M3 will probably be a 3, like based on what we're seeing.
Okay.
Yeah. So, there's going to be a lot of, once these chips are actually released and once benchmarks are actually come out, there will be a lot of headlines that say, you know, ha ha ha, the M1 Max isn't as good as everyone thinks it is. But okay. I think that's a little bit of hyperbole that's not necessary.
Yeah. Fair enough.
And you know, there's a thing we say it all the time. It's not something until Apple does it. And this hybrid architecture for these chips, which is again the core split between performance and power.
Mm-hmm.
AMD's been doing it for a while. It's not a new thing. Snapdragon, Qualcomm Snapdragons, they're not. It's not a new process. But once Apple started doing it, then Intel appeared to notice that maybe they should get into it as well. I don't have any inside Intel information, but it's all they convenient. That once Apple started doing it, all of a sudden now they're shifting their main chips now to this hybrid power efficiency architecture.
All right. So I think that was a pretty thorough overview. So I wanted to talk a little bit now. I guess it was last week. I'm getting my days confused a little bit. That Google announced and the Pixel 6 and the Pixel 6 Pro. That was last week.
Okay. The 19th.
Even when I was preparing for this, I was like, I don't remember if it was 2 weeks ago or it was just last week.
Google got a little caught up in the Apple thing. It was unfortunate timing for them.
So I wanted to talk a little bit about the Tensor chip, because this is a big step for Google to be making its own system on a chip. And I know that we're kind of talking about how these things are reminiscent perhaps of what Apple has done, but I'll link also J.R. Raphael's article about the Pixel 6 and the Pixel 6 Pro in the description. But I guess I'm just saying it's big. How does it run? I guess I'm sure J.R. talks about this in the article.
I haven't tested it because I don't do that stuff anymore. But I did see a video comparing the iPhone 13 to the 13. Yeah, right. That's right. iPhone 13 to the iPhone 13 Pro to the Pixel 6 Pro. And at first, you know, so what this thing does is it's like a robotic arm that opens applications, waits for them to load, and then closes them and opens up another one just to test the responsiveness of the chip. At first, the Pixel was ahead by a bit of time, you know, maybe 5 seconds or so, which I think speaks to the RAM. The Pixel 6 Pro has 12 gigs of RAM, whereas the iPhone has, I think, six or eight. I don't remember.
Six, I think.
Okay. So yeah. That's a lot. That's a lot of RAM. So you're able to access those things quicker. But when it came to processing something like a video render or something like that, or I think it was an export of something, the iPhone blew it away. I mean, so Apple's chips, you know, like the Pixel will maybe seem faster at certain points. It cannot compete with the speed, and from what I read, the efficiency of the A15 processor. I mean, they're not even on the same level. I don't think that's what Google was necessarily going for here, but it's important that becomes a focus, because if you're paying $900 for a phone and up, you want the best performance. And right now it does not appear, even when you compare it to the Snapdragon 888 in the S21, like it's not on the same level as that stuff. And yeah, okay, Google's prioritizing the Tensor stuff, which is AI, mm-hmm. and the things that it does. Now bringing that to the chip level, okay. I think more important is the speed and the graphic power and things like that. And I don't know if the Pixel 6 Pro delivers it at that price range.
Gotcha. You know, big picture point though, you've got Google developing chips, you've got Intel responding to Apple. Yeah. You've got Apple is basically a major chip maker now. You know, there's a lot of investment energy and innovation coming from these companies at this point, and mm-hmm. and that's good. You know, I mean, yeah. you can argue benchmarks all the time, all day long, depending on exactly what you're doing and under what circumstances. But you know, these, you know, the Tensor is a good chip. I'm sure the Alder Lake will be a good chip, and the M1 Max is a good chip. You know, and beyond that, the details at this point, I think, are sort of meaningless.
Fair enough. So we have one quick viewer question before we transition over, because we've been talking about chips and then we're going to be talking about how companies have been getting them. So we have just one question. I think, Mike, this is maybe more of a question for you. They're asking about the A15 Bionic chip. Is this the first time that Apple has gone with sort of like the Bionic labeling?
Mm-mm. No, what, okay. Introduced it with the 12.
What makes it different? Is there a difference, or is that just a fancy name?
It's a fancy new name, but it refers to the neural engine that it released with the that it introduced with the A12. So that handles all the machine learning AI stuff. That's really what it is. It's a fancy marketing name.
Okay,
it's marketing. Yeah.
But the Bionic nomenclature came along when they introduced that neural engine with the A12. So
gotcha. So to the viewer who asked,
but yeah, it doesn't necessarily mean anything.
Okay. Well, thank you both so much for joining. I know this was a little bit quick, but I think we covered a lot. And I think you made a great conclusion point there, Ken, about, you know, new chips, they're coming out, they're fast, it's competition. Ultimately, I mean, it'll be exciting to see, and it probably a net good, I'm sure, for the consumer at minimum. So
I mean, competition is always good.
Mm-hmm.
It's
like
always
chips.
Yeah,
and
when these
is good. Yeah,
when companies respond to what other companies are doing. I mean, think about back in the 90s when they were doing those Pentium bake-offs. I would literally bring Intel machines on stage. It's all good for us.
Yeah.
Yep. Great. Well, thank you both so much, and we will see you, I'm sure, next week